So far, we've only made programs that would do the same thing every time. And while that is cool, programming doesn't start to get really interesting before we can have our program determine what to do next based on what we tell it. This is where the if statement comes in. If statements allow us to check for a condition and execute different code depending on if it's true or false. Say, for example, we want to create a quiz game. Here we need to check if the player's answers are correct. And we can of course do that using an if statement. In this case, we could have the program ask something like, what's the best movie trilogy of all time? We could then collect some input from the player and check if it corresponds to the correct answer. If it does, and the user typed in Lord of the Rings, we can print out correct. If it doesn't, and the user typed in, well, anything else, we can print out incorrect and send them directly to the fiery depths of Mordor. So, if statements is one of the most essential tools for any programmer. But before we get into it, this video is sponsored by Dennis Panduta. Dennis is an awesome game dev tutor who's just updated his super successful complete C# masterclass. This class will make you super comfortable writing code in C# and using it for programming your own games in Unity. It will give you knowledge on many different aspects of C# and teach topics such as databases, link and WPF, and much more. At the end of the course, you will even have made 3 games on your own. If this sounds like something you're interested in, simply click the link in the description to get started and get a massive discount. Now, when we want to write an if statement, the syntax is actually quite simple. We write if, then some parentheses, and then we open and close some curly brackets. Inside the parentheses, we put our condition. In other words, what we want to check for. In the case of our quiz game, we probably have some kind of player answer variable that holds whatever the player typed in. We can check if this is equal to Lord of the Rings. If it is, our condition is met and everything inside of the curly brackets will be executed. So in this case, we would print out correct. Of course, we often want to define what happens if the condition isn't met. If this is the case, we use an if-else statement. This is as simple as writing else at the bottom, followed by 2 curly brackets, where we can put what we want to happen if the condition isn't met. In this case, we would print out incorrect. And take them to Isengard.
Mordor!
Now, we can use different symbols to create conditions. The double equals means is equal to, and an exclamation sign and an equal sign means is not equal to. If you're dealing with numbers, the greater than or less than signs can be used to check if a number is greater than or less than the other number. And if we put an equal sign after that, it means greater than or equal to, or less than or equal to. Of course, I don't expect you to remember this right away, so here's a table that you can look at if in doubt. And with that, let's write some code. So let's say that you're going to the cinema to watch a movie and you want to buy a ticket. Well, using if statements, we can create a program that allows you to do this. So let's first of all use console.writeLine to just print out something like welcome. Tickets are $5. Please insert cash. Then we can have the user insert some cash. In our case, let's store this in an integer. So we'll create an integer called cash and set it equal to console.readline. And remember, like we talked about in our last video on variables, we first have to convert this to an integer. So we'll use convert.toInt32 and wrap the parentheses around the readline. There we go. So we've now asked the user to input some cash and the user can then type in a number, which is the amount of dollars they put in. What we can then do is use an if statement to do something based on how much they put in. So we make some new lines here and we write if, then parentheses, and then we write the condition. In our case, we can check if cash is less than 5 because the ticket price is $5. Well, in this case, the user hasn't put in enough money. So we can go ahead and open and close some curly brackets. And I'm just going to put them down here on a separate line so it's very clear that inside of these curly brackets is what is going to happen if this condition is true. And we can just put something in here like console.writeLine. That's not enough money. There we go. So if the user inputs less than $5, we're going to print out that that's not enough. And right away, if we run this program, we can see it says, welcome, tickets are $5, please insert cash. I'm going to type in 3 here, and it says, that's not enough money. Awesome. But we of course also want to write what happens when the user inputs enough. For that, we can use an if-else. So right now we're saying, if we input less than $5, do this. Then after that, we can write else. So in all other cases, and again, I'm going to put this on a separate line, just to make it easier to read. So if the user inputs $5 or more, then we can write, here is your ticket, and print out a ticket for them. And again, if we run this program now, and we type in $5, it says, here's your ticket. Awesome. But if the user inputs more than $5, we want to give them their ticket as well as some change. So we actually need to add a separate condition for this. And we can do this using an else if. So if the user inputs less than $5, we write out that's not enough money. If not, then we can check. So else if cash is equal to 5. So if the user inputs exactly $5, then we can write out here's your ticket. And if not, so we can put another else statement here. If not, well, then it's not less than $5 and it's not equal to $5, so it's more than $5. And here we can go ahead and calculate how much change we should give back to the user. So we could use a variable, call it change, and set it equal to the amount of cash that is put in minus 5, which is the ticket price. And so that's how much we want to give back. And so we can write out console.writeLine, here is your ticket, and then the change, dollars in change. There we go. So we basically have three different states here, less than $5, equal to $5, or more than $5. And we're using this by just chaining together if and else if statements. Really, really cool. And if we go ahead and run this now, we can see that if we input more than $5, so I'm going to put in, say, $8 here, it says, here's your ticket and $3 in change. Awesome, so that's a great way to start using if statements in your code to do different things depending on whether or not a condition is met. Let's have a look at another example. So imagine that we're at a theme park and we want to create a program that checks whether or not people are allowed to go onto a roller coaster. Well, in this case, we want to determine this based on the age and height of the user. So as you can see at the top here, I'm declaring two variables, an integer for the age, and an integer for the height, so two simple numbers. I'm then asking the user to input their age and collecting it just like we did before. And after that, I ask the user to input their height in centimeters, and again, we collect that just like before. If I just quickly run this program, we can see that I can input an age, let's just do 24, and a height, let's just do 190. There we go. So we can now use if statements to determine if the user can enter the roller coaster based on these two variables. So just like before, we can create some lines and we can check if age is greater than or equal to 18. Well, then we can write out console.writeLine, you can enter. Notice how this time I'm just leaving the curly bracket up here. It does the exact same thing. If this is harder for you to read, feel free to put it on a separate line. But this is just shorter and kind of the standard practice these days. So now we're saying that anyone who is 18 or older can enter the roller coaster. But we also want to check if the person is tall enough. To do this, we could go in here and create another if statement inside the other one. So we could go if height is greater than or equal to, let's say, 160 centimeters. Well, then the person can enter and then put this in here. This is called nesting because we're putting one if statement inside of another. But that's actually an easier way to do this. So instead of creating two if statements, we can just go up here and add another condition that needs to be met. To do that, we use two ampersand signs. This means and. So if age is greater than or equal to 18 and height is greater than or equal to 160, well, then this condition is met and we can go ahead and write you can enter. And if not, so we'll put an else here, console. .writeLine, you don't meet the requirements. And if we try and run this, we need to put an age, let's say 22, that's old enough, and a height, and let's do something that isn't tall enough, so let's just input 140. And as you can see, it says you don't meet the requirements, because only one of the variables is correct. Whereas if we rerun the program and input 22 and then let's say 190, it says you can enter. And just like we can check whether both of these conditions are true, we can also check if just one of them is. That's the OR sign, or two vertical bars. So this means that the condition is met if either of these two are true. So if we're older than 18 or our height is greater than 160. So if we save that and run it now, we can input an age of 14, which is not old enough, and then a height which is large enough, so 180, we can see that it says you can enter, because now one of the conditions is met. So that's how you can work with multiple conditions. Awesome! Now for the challenge before the next video, I would like you to create a program, kind of a game actually, where the player has to solve math problems. An example of this could be 10 times 2 plus 3. So the answer to this is of course 10 times 2, which is 20, plus 3, which is 23. And so you have to show the user a problem, have them input an answer, and if the answer is correct, you can tell the user that it's correct. If not, you have to tell them that it's wrong. So in my program here, I'm showing 15 plus 2 times 2. That's 15 plus 4, or 19, which is correct, and it tells me so. And then it actually gives me another problem. Let's say I get this answer wrong and say that's 12, which is wrong, and it shows that. And then there's a final one here, and I believe the answer to this is 6, which is correct. So I've just put in 3 problems here. You can put in as many as you want, but that is your challenge for the next video. So before we end, I just want to show you one quick thing, which is the switch statement. So here I have an example where I ask the user to input a number between 1 and 5. We then collect the number as we normally do, and then we want to do something based on what number was passed in. So we have all of these if statements here to check for the different cases. So if the number is 1, then we just write out 1 in the console. Else, if it's 2, we write out 2. If it's 3, we write out 3. The same with 4 and 5. And while this is totally valid and it should work, in fact, if we run our program and type in a number, I'm going to type in 3 here, we can see that it prints out 3. However, whenever we are dealing with a single variable that can have many different values and we want to do something based on the value, that is the perfect example of where a switch statement is really useful. So instead of writing this chain of if statements here, we can actually delete that and we can write switch. We then give it the variable that we want to check for. In my case here, I called that num, and then open and close some curly brackets. And inside of these, we can then create code for the different cases. So in the case that num here is 1, so case 1, and then a colon, and then underneath here, we put in what happens. So in our case, we want to write out console.writeLine 1. And we can put multiple lines of code here, we can do more stuff, or we could just end it here by typing break and then a semicolon. So that is the syntax. So we're basically saying that we want to switch based on the num variable, and in the case that it's 1, we go ahead and do something. In our case, we write out 1, and then we break. And we can do that for all of the different cases. So we could go case 2, so in the case that this number is 2, we write out 2, and then break. And we can keep going like this for all of the different numbers, so I'm just going to do that. So as you can see, while this works in the exact same way as before, and it takes up just about the same amount of space, it actually makes it much easier to tell what's going on. We're switching based on the num variable, and we can clearly see the different cases. And the cool thing about a switch is that we're not sure that we're going to pass in a value between 1 and 5, so we can actually put in a default case here, which is going to happen if none of these cases are met. So in this case, we could just write out console.writeLine default, and then again a break. And now if we run this program here, and if we type a value that isn't between 1 and 5, let's say 7, we can see it says default. So now for all other values that aren't added as a case here, it's just going to go to the default state. So that's a switch statement. There's really not more to it. You can choose if you want to use this or if statements. It's completely up to you.
That's pretty much it for this video. If you enjoyed it, make sure to subscribe and ring that notification bell so you don't miss the next one. As always, you can find my solution to this week's challenge on the Brackeys forum. There's of course a link to that in the description. Also, make sure to go check out the complete C# masterclass by clicking the link in the description. Other than that, thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.
Thanks to the awesome Patreon supporters who donated in June, and a special thanks to Nubby Ninja, Face Amerify, Lost to Violence Love Forever, SIT Mike, Piano Sethorn Lack, Replica Studios, Jason Uetescu, Leo Lissette, Alison the Fierce, Michael Korobov, Owen Cooper, Gregory Pierce, Naoki Iwasaki, Dante Sam, Donatian Gascoigne, Sirius Wolf, The Mighty Zeus, Jacob Sanford, Magantorn Girard, and Erasmus. You guys rock.